Hello guys, Flying Dutchie here, welcome back to our EU4 tutorial for complete beginners. Last episode we spoke about the trade goods on the map and what trade value is and how trade works with the trade power in certain provinces and how you can steer away trade from other nodes and if you should collect or not in your home node, which is not needed. In this episode we're going to talk about the ledger and we're going to keep playing and then I think we can go to war with Granada, which we are waiting for a long time. Now first we're gonna go to the ledger, and the ledger is over here next to the menu. So you can click the menu here, get your game options and whatever you want to do. But the ledger is over here, and this is some sort of a information book of the game with a lot of tabs. Now you can see that there is a country index, military, economy, trade and relations. And over here, it's the same, I think. Yeah. Country, military, economy, trade, and relations. I don't know why these buttons are here and also here, actually. Oh, I know actually why it is. When I click this, I immediately go to that page. And not over here. If I click here, it opens a list of all the information you want to find in the game. Of countries. Military. You can look at the armies of other nations, navies. National armies, national navies, our armies and navies, our regiments and the ships we build. You can look at all your economy stuff. You can see every trade node, trade goods, country trade comparisons, and all friendly relations, hostile, coalitions, cas bellies that we have, and current wars in the world. But there's a lot of information. I will go over all the pages and give a quick, explanation. So we are on page 1, which is the ledger index menu. That's this page. Now let's go next to page 2. Here is the country ledger. You can click on your allies, you can sort for information for your allies, for your rivals, for example France, who you're at war with, who you have negative opinion or positive opinion with. And you can sort on stability. How much prestige do nations have? France is having the highest prestige at the moment. Who has the highest income? The Mamluks. We are second. We have the second highest income in the game right now. Who has the highest inflation in the game? Who has the highest treasury money? We have 397. The Mamluks have almost 700 income waiting. They can spend that on buildings and all kinds of other things. Who's having the highest development in the game? It's the Mamluks again. We are fourth. How much manpower can each nation have at its maximum? It's Austria. That's because they are the Holy Roman Emperor. They get a bonus. You can see it here. 33,000. This is really nice to see all information. And you can get a view of how good we are doing it. Now, we are doing really well. We have a good income. And we have a good development. We have a high development in the game at the moment. So, we are doing really well. You can see governments. I never use this one. You can see which government there is in the game. There are monarchies. There are republics. Theocracies. And there are tribal governments. You can see the legitimacy of all the countries. Admin efficiency. We don't talk about that until the later game. Absolutism is also a later game. Score is just this number over here. It's not really something you would go for a single player game. You could, for example, just do a multiplayer game with your friends and say, okay, who has the highest score will win in that year. And then you have a multiplayer game. But the score is not important. It doesn't do anything. This is the score through all the ages. We are now the age of discovery. And later on we go to the age of reformation. And then the score, you can sort with age will have the highest score with nation. Score over time. You can even see a graph from all the nations in the world. You can select those nations on and off. You can see all the technologies of all the nations in the game. Once again, you can always sort on your allies, rivals, and so on. Which religions are there in the game? And you can sort on countries of provinces. So there are 130 countries Catholic right now in the world, 94 are Sunni, 60 are Hindu, and so on, and so on, and so on, and so on. And these are all the religions in the game. All with their own bonuses. At the moment, there is no Zoroastrian, Jewish, Norse, or Hussite religion in the game. But there are provinces with that religion. Except for Norse. Norse is the only religion with zero provinces. Your states and territories, how much development you have in a certain state, how much provinces there are in one state, and what the maintenance is. You can sort on all your provinces which trade good there is, how much base production, base tax, or base manpower there is. For example, Madrid is our best province for base manpower, and we have the most manpower a month here as well. This is our yearly manpower, I think. Yeah, must be. You can sort on base production and production income. For example, our gold mine is giving us 24 ducats a month. Sevilla is the second best province for production. But you see what the difference is with the production income of gold and other trade goods. You can see your development in the whole world. So if I click on the development and sort it on this one, we see that Florence is the highest developed province in the world that we know of. We don't know about India and China. We can't see it right now. But the world we know of, Florence is the highest developed province. These are our possible colonies. This is going to be very handy when we are going to start colonizing. In this list you can see which provinces you discovered and that you can reach to colonize. At the moment we can only colonize Tenerife. Tenerife is over here. I cannot move the ledger, but it's over here. This is Tenerife. These four islands is one province. And we could colonize it right now, but we have no colonists, so we cannot do it. The number of provinces in a graph. The colonies we have right now, which is zero. The advisors, all in the game. All advisors that we know of, I think, that are picked by a nation. The military leaders in the world. Now overall, you can see that Skanderbeg from Albania is the best leader at the start of the game. And that's true. When you play as Albania, over here, which is a very hard start because the Ottomans will kill you, normally. You have a 5 fire, 5 shock and 5 maneuver skilled general. Now, you don't need to know what this is yet. We will talk about these modifiers when we go to war. But just remember, at the start of the game you need shock. And later in the game when you have good cannons, you need fire pips. So shock pips is the most important at the start of the game. The current rulers for every country and from when, the age, and so on. The Holy Roman Emperors of the Holy Roman Empire that we will talk about later. At the moment it is Friedrich III from Habsburg. He is the Holy Roman Emperor since 1439. The previous rulers of our country. And this is just some information from before the start date. And this is a very important one. Here you can see the armies in the world that you know of. So if I click on total, you can see that we have the highest amount of armies in the world. The Mamluks is having 30,000. We have 13,600 manpower. The Mamluks have almost 30,000 manpower, so they can reinforce their army more than we can. And this is another important number, the force limit. Let's sort on it. If Austria was rich enough to maintain a big army, they can do this without penalties to 61,000 troops. They have now 21,000. But if they became powerful and get a lot of money, they could make a 61,000 army. And our rival France could make 38,000. But what do we see here? They only have 18,000 troops. And they have no manpower. They only have 510. That's because they had a battle with England. England has also no manpower, but a bigger standing army. So maybe England could do more if they would not peace out. But these nations are now they need to recover a couple of years from this by gaining manpower over time and rebuilding the army. So if I was bordering France now, and I would own all of this, This would be a good moment to go to war with France, because they are weak. And the AI does that as well to you. When you are weak, the AI is more likely to attack you. So you can see all the armies of all the countries, you can do all your allies. Oh, we see that Austria and Aragon and Portugal have a decent army. My rivals, not so much. The same count for navies. England is having the most heavy ships at the start of the game. Morocco, our rival, is actually having 4 heavy ships. That is amazing, because they are very expensive. So sort on your total fleet. We see that Morocco has 18 boats, we have 22, England have 35 ships, Venice 34. And the force limit again. Force limit and what they have right now. The national armies, what is this? These are my two armies I have. My two navies, my trade fleet and my other fleet. Not very important, regiments. Ships, not very important, that we know that already. Income comparison with every country in the world. Now, what is this? 84. And we have 22. Oh yeah, France is having 70 spoils of war. England had to pay France money for the war. Maybe you remember it. England only paid 70 ducats and they did not lose land. That is also calculated in this total. That's a bit... It brings you on a... How do you say that in English? I don't know. It's wrong. This number should not be here. Because this gives you a bad outlook on how it really is. Income overview, our income overview, production, gold, taxation and trade for the whole year. Last year and this year. Income graphs, inflation graphs of all the nation. These are the charts. We are 100% Catholic. We have these kinds of trade goods in our country. We have these cultures in our country. And all our provinces are cored, which is good, because then we get more out of it. More taxation, more production, more manpower, more sailors. Technology overview, not very helpful. You can see that anywhere else as well. Where do we pay for? We pay for our maintenance, for our advisors, army, fleet and forts. And state maintenance. We have no loans. These are all the trade notes in the game. And you can see where the most trade power is. And that at the moment is in Genoa and the English Channel. There's 13 ducats there to get. These are all the trade goods in the world. So we can look at the current price. We see that gems, dyes, silk, cocoa and ivory have the highest price. And they will give the most trade value and the most production income. You can get a bonus if you trade the most in a certain good, and these are the bonuses you can get. At the moment we don't have any bonus. If you have a bonus, I think it will be highlighted. You can see that Ming, that we don't know about, is in China, has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 flags over here, and he is having 1, 2, 3 trade bonuses, so Ming should be very powerful. But we don't know that, because we don't know where Ming is. Good locations, not very helpful. Country trade comparison, just the trade income comparison. What's up? Trade efficiency, our mercantilism that I talked about last episode, and so on. Lightships, how much we protect trade with. Our friendly relations, we have an alliance with Aragon, Portugal. And Austria, do we have a royal marriage? Yes. Hostile relations. Those are the countries we have a casus belli on. So we are allied with Aragon, but we also have a CB on Aragon, I think. That's why they are listed over here. Not very helpful, the screen, you should not use it. Coalitions, we'll talk about that later. If you conquer too quickly, you can get a coalition against you and you will die. These are all RCBs we have right now. Oh yeah, we have a excommunicated ruler CB against Aragon, because the Pope excommunicated Aragon. So every nation in the world can that is Catholic can go to war with Aragon without penalties. And also Navarra is excommunicated. And England, France and Morocco are rivals, and you can use the Humiliate Rival CB against these nations. But you should not use it, because you cannot conquer land with this casus belli. But when we go to war, I will talk about the CBs. These are the current wars in the game. Now you can see how many people are at war. Ottomans are at war with Serbia, Athens and Byzantium, for example. And then we are back. That's the whole ledger interface. And the most important are the military armies ones, to see and compare your army with other countries and see if you can actually beat them. Now, let's pause the game. I think we will go to war soon, because we need 60% of our manpower to fulfill our first mission. We made a lot of money in the meantime, which is really good. Let me check my rulers, by the way. Now, you can see that our air is absolutely garbage. These are the lowest stats you can get for a king, so it would be so good if this one would die. Because if our heir dies, we can get a new heir. Now there is a DLC where you can disinherit your heir for some, I think, prestige penalty. I think 50 prestige penalty. So we cannot do it right now, but there's another way how you maybe can get rid of your heir. And that is by making your heir into a general for your army. So I'm going to make Enrique here, our heir, this 24 years old, into a general for an army, and then he has a higher chance of dying, and we want him to die, so that's good. So I will select my army, and you can see there's no leader in the army, so I click on the no leader. Now we do have a leader at the start with two shock pips, which are important at the start, and two fire pips, which are not that important, and you have four buttons here when you are in the screen. You can make another general for 50 military points. You can make a conquistador, but we cannot do this right now, because we cannot colonize yet. You can make your ruler into a military commander, and our heir into a military commander. So I'm going to make my heir into a military commander, because generals have a high risk of dying on the battlefield. So that's what we want. I click this button, and then we get a random stats that the game will decide how many pips we get. And he is absolutely garbage. We have no shock and no fire pips, so we have no battle modifications. We have only one maneuver and one siege bonus, so when we siege down a fort, this goes a little bit quicker. I put him in the army. You see this one star, he's a one star general, and now he has a higher chance to die. And we want that, because he is not good. We don't want him to lead the country. Oh no, that would be a disaster. Gonna let the game run on speed 4 and wait for our mission to complete, and then we will go to war. Some random event far away. Aragon wants military access from us against the war of Naples, Venice and Florence. Yeah, sure. They are my ally, so I will give them military access. Some countries are fighting each other over here. Tunis full annexed a country. I think Tunis fully annexed these two provinces. Now let's check in the production interface if we still have our full army force limit and our navy. Yes, we have 22 out of 22. We are now waiting for the mission to complete. And as I talked before, every 50 years you get a new institution. And we now have the Renaissance institution spreading in 1450. We improved with Aragon until our maximum, so we're gonna recall this diplomat. He doesn't have any benefit here, and I will improve with Portugal, my other ally. There we go. Now, what happened with the institution? You should have the institution's map mode listed here as well as one of your important ones. Let's click on it. So it is 1450, and you can see that most of the world is now yellow or striped. And that's because the nations need to embrace the next institution. In 1450, the Renaissance became available, and you can see here with this the sign here that Mantova is the birthplace of the Renaissance. You can see it over here, and it is not striped. So this is the only province in the world where the Renaissance is present. And that means that Mantua can now embrace it and have no tech penalties. That is the most important thing to remember. The longer it takes for you to get your institution, the longer it will last you with negative penalties for your tech rate. If I go to my technology screen, we have no institution tech penalty, but every year we get 1% extra. So if we cannot embrace the institution until 1460, we have a 10% penalty we need to pay for our technologies. That's a lot of points. So how do we get it then? How do we get the institution? Now you can see all those stripes, right? That means that these provinces are actually developing it right now. For example, the province of our capital, Toledo, is having stripes. So let's click on the province. And then there is this book here where you can see the institutions. You can see that the Renaissance here is spreading with 0.07% each month, which is not a lot. Every European 10 development province is getting a growth. And that is why the provinces we see with stripes are actually having stripes. These are provinces with more than 10 or more development. If I go to Avila, there are no stripes here. It's 6 development, so the institution will not grow here by itself. Now, how can we speed this up? How can we get this institution quicker? And let's have a look in Toledo. This is our capital. And we see that at the moment we have 0.07 growth per month. And let's have a look at these modifiers. Our European 10 development is 0.5. If I have a nearby friendly province that has Renaissance, we get a huge bonus, but that's not available right now. If I have an adjacent province of myself with Renaissance, we get a bonus. If we have a European 5 development province after 1500, it will go very quickly that way. So it will go quicker automatically. And then there is the last one that we can maybe can get. There's a European 20 development province modifier. If we can get a province with 20 development, the Renaissance will spread quicker. Now we have 14 in Toledo. And Sevilla is having 16. Now I think Sevilla is maybe the best province at the start of the game to develop and get this to 20 development so that your Renaissance will get here quicker. At the moment it will be here in 1537. That is way too long. So I think I'm gonna develop Sevilla to 20 development so we can get an extra modifier. And then it can become available here first and then spread around. And when a certain amount of your provinces is having the institution, you can embrace it for money. And I think I'm gonna do this, but the thing is, it's very expensive. It's 60 over here, in Toledo it's 50, and Madrid is 59. Now I still think Toledo is the best, Sevilla is the best province to do this. Not only do I get more institution spread, but I also get more trade power for every click. And since we have so many modifiers here, and later on when we build buildings we get even more trade power, this number can become so much higher. So I think I'm gonna develop, but for which things? I think I'm gonna spend a little bit of military power. And I don't know actually. It's also very nice to have your next technology. If you have a technology advance on another country, you have a better chance of winning. What if France takes military tech 4 and I have still tech 3 and they declare war on me? Then we are going to lose very, very hard. We have no chance of winning then. And that's what you need to do. You need to decide, what do I want to spend my points on? Do I want to get to 20 development and get the institution quicker? Or do I want the technology first? I think I'm going to get tech 4 diplo and tech 4 military first. And then we are going to spend some points. I think that's the best thing to do. So we are not going to develop this province right now to 20, but later. Now there are DLCs where you can have state edicts, and that also can be very helpful with cheaper developing, conversion rate of provinces, and all other things. I don't know which DLC that is. I think the state edicts are pretty important, so I'm going to write that down. I'm going to find out which DLC that is for the state edicts. State edicts. That's also something you would really like in your game. But for your first game, you don't need it. Okay, we spoken about that feature. Institutions. I think I'm gonna go and let the game run again. Now, when we can complete our mission, we will get a pop-up, so I don't have to check all the time. The Great Horde declared war on Riazan, okay. $500 money. Oh yeah, and when you have $500 money, you can become the Defender of the Faith. And that is in your religious tab, in your country view. And it costs 500 ducats, and you get an extra missionary, you get more other bonuses. Also more yearly papal influence, which is something we are looking for. But 500 ducats at this point of the game is too much. We need our money to build buildings in our country very soon. So we're not gonna become Defender of the Faith. And what does that mean when you are Defender of the Faith? If, for example, the Ottomans declare war on Hungary. Hungary is Catholic. Ottomans are Sunni. A Sunni country or another religious country attacks a Catholic country, you will be called in as a defender. And if you do not accept, you lose the Defender of the Faith title. So you need to accept it if you want to keep it. Maybe not that handy in your first game to become Defender of the Faith and involve yourself in wars you're not ready for. We lost the excommunicated ruler CB against Aragon, so that means that Aragon is now back in communion. Yes, they are. And hey, look at this, we fulfilled our mission. We have 60% of our manpower, we have one general, and we have our force limit completed. And we can complete this, and for 15 years we get some morale boosts, and we get a permanent claim on Upper Andalusia. There we go. When I click on my Diplo map mode, we can now see the stripes here. We have claims on these provinces, so we can now go to war without losing stability and getting a lot of aggressive expansion. And we have a valid reason to go to war now. And we will do this. Now, something very important before you declare the wars. Make sure your army is at full morale. Remember that I put my morale slider down to make more money. Before you go to war, you have to do a checklist for yourself. One, is my army maintenance high up? Two, is my fleet maintenance high up? They are. Then three, what is my technology of military compared to my enemy? I have level 3. Granada also level 3, so we will have the same strength. How much armies do they have? They have 5,000 armies and they have 11,000 manpower. I have 33,000 armies and I have 16,000 manpower. So we are the same technology. We are the same strength, almost the same strength. And we have way more troops, so it looks really good. But the last thing you need to check is, what are their alliances? They are allied with Tunis, the country over here. So if I would click declare war, you can click this and you will not go to war immediately. You actually see that we don't have a CB. You need to let the game run for 1 month and let the game update your CB. So we cannot go to war right now. I could, but then I have no CB and we will get a lot of penalties. So we're going to click this away and let the game run for a couple of months. Let's do 1 month first. Oh, actually 1 day. You need to wait 1 day and then you get your claims. So we finish the mission. You let the game run 1 day and now we have our CBs, our conquest casus bellis against Granada. So if I would declare one now, you see this in your list. And here you can see who is going to join who. If I would go to war for Granada here, it doesn't really matter which province you take actually. Just click one of the four. You can get all four with one click here. We see that Tunis will join the side of Granada. You can see why they join here. It's a defensive war and they trust Granada. And the attitude to Granada is not that high. They have a bit of war exhaustion because of their last war and they have a bit of low manpower, but they still want to join. Now, who's going to join me? Austria does not want to join. It's too far away. They have no manpower and they have no strength. Aragon is fighting in another war. They are being occupied and besieged and they have war exhaustion. They are at war with Venice and Venice is occupying his fort here. So Aragon is not in a situation that they can say, I'm gonna join your war. No, they have too much problem with the war they are in right now. But we could call in Portugal. Portugal also hates Granada. We have a good diplomatic reputation and they trust us a bit. Now, if we want to have Portugal in a war, and I do this. And you should not click this. This means that you make the ally of our enemy, Granada's ally Tunis, a co-belligerent. And what does that mean? If I do this, Tunis can also call in his allies. Now let's have a look at Tunis's allies. Okay, they are only allied with Granada. So in this situation, making Tunis co-belligerent can be a good thing, because they have no one else to call in the war. And if I make Tunis a co-belligerent, like this, you can see the tooltip, the enemy will be considered a co-belligerent in this war. They will be able to call in their own allies, but they only ally Granada, so they cannot call in more people. That's good. And when you click this, you can take more land. That's actually the most important thing to know, from Tunis. Now, do we want to take land from Tunis? Maybe I will. But the most important is that we take the Granada land. I think I'm gonna make him co-belligerent, because he cannot call in more people. If he would be allied with the Ottomans, for example, I would not make him co-belligerent, and I would do it like this, without the checkmark. But if I declare like this, taking land from Tunis will be very costly, and people are gonna hate you way more than when you do it like this. So, I'm gonna do it like this, because Tunis is having no allies. Otherwise, I would do it like this. But I'm not gonna go to war right now, because I just raised my army maintenance, and it takes a couple of months before your morale in your army is restored. You can see it over here. You want a full green bar before you go to war. So you need to wait a couple of months. And I will go back to speed 3 from this point, because we will go to war soon. We got the event, poor government policies. When you get these options, maybe never lose stability. If you lose stability, when we go from plus 1 to 0, you lose 100 admin points. That's how I see it. I prefer to lose some government reform progress. That's this thing here. We can wait for these. Government reform progress, that's no problem. Before you declare war, maybe you should get one or two generals. Now, we made our heir into a general. That's in this army, which is this icon. The 15,000 army has no general. Now, a leader or a general. I call them generals. We had one from the start of the game. Alvaro de Luna. who is a decent general, so I'm gonna select him for this army. Make sure you don't make generals at the start of the game, because they cost 50 military points, and the only thing you want to go for at the start of the game is increasing your military technology. It's so important. And making your heir into a general is free. So maybe you should make your king or your general, the one who is having bad stats, into a general. If you would make a new one, it costs 50 military points. If I would make my king into a general, it's free. Keep your military points for technology. So you can see this bar going up. Now the last thing you need to do before you go to war is combine your navies. This 9000 lightships are very vulnerable when they are out alone. So what I'm gonna do is send my lightships to Cadiz together with my other fleet and combine them together. So there they are. I will select and press the G button or the merge button. And now they are in one army. You could get an admiral, but once again, you spend 50 diplo points, and that is very costly. We need these points for colonization and maybe developing our gold mine. So I'm not gonna get an admiral. And the other reason is that Portugal is gonna join our war, and they do have an admiral. And they could join our fleet with their admiral, and together we will fight under his admiral against the enemy. And then we have a better chance, I think. So I'm gonna let the game run. I think I wait one more month, and then this bar is almost 100%, and then we go to war. Oh, we got another event for more power. I always take the inflation one, because we get more power, and that's more important than inflation. There we go. Our army is ready. And before you declare war, just check again what their technology is. 3. I have 3. They are allied with Tunis. Tunis will join. And that, yeah, and this is our problem. When you wait a couple of months, things in the game can change. And this is happening a lot of times. Portugal is now in another war, and they don't want to join anymore. So now, suddenly, we have to do this war on our own. I'm still gonna do it because I'm good enough. But this war against Tunis and Granada together can be a bit harsh for you as a new player. Now before I declare war, I check again which are the allies of Tunis. Now they have no other allies, so I'm gonna make them co-belligerent. And then I will go to war for Granada here and declare war. Here you can see the total amount of troops from both sides. Granada and Tunis have 12,000 infantry, 3,000 cavalry, and a force limit of 40,000. So our army alone against these two nations is bigger as well. So I'm gonna go to war. You hear this the sound here. And Tunis honored the alliance with Granada, so we are now at war with Tunis and Granada. When you go to the diplomacy screen, they are red on the map. Blue are alliances, red are enemies, stripes are claims. Green stripes are your cores in other countries. And now we go to war. And we will play the war in the next episode. And then I'm going to explain how you siege forts, how you use your armies, and where you need to watch out for. So please like the video, and I hope to see you in the next part. Bye bye.